going to JPL. Everyone kept telling me, you need to find Joe. And I did have to go too far because he was collaborating with my boss there. So it was a very natural connection. But just a little bit of the background about Joe. He is currently a member of the Radar Science and Engineering section at JPL. His overall primary interest is atmospheric passive active remote sensing related to clouds and precipitation, and the observations needed to improve their representation in weather and climate models. Prior to his work at NASA JPL, he worked for NRL, which is the Naval Research Laboratory in Monterey, California, where I was there too a few years ago. And he has been active in NASA's STRIM and GPN science teams, served as an editor for the AMS Journal of Hydrometeorology, is an active or has been active in the organization of CDMS and WMO International Precipitation Working Group since its inception. He received his undergraduate degrees from Michigan Technological University, and after a period in industry, so for the students who want to go to industry, you might want to ask Joe a couple questions about that. So after a period in industry, his PhD from Colorado State University in electrical engineering, where he became interested in radar meteorology using the CSU and NCAR S-band polarimetric radar systems. When not analyzing the treasure trove, I love this, the treasure trove of information buried in the archives of NASA's environmental satellite data, you can often find him on his bike exploring the hills of mountains and mountains of Southern California. And I heard he's a really hardcore cyclist, and not to mess with him when he's going uphill.
Still recovering.
All right. Without further ado, you have the floor.
Thank you, Myra. Thank you for having me, and good to meet everybody. Myra did a good job. My little slide where I actually have a little news about myself, but it's good to cover all that. So I'll talk about a little project that actually Myra was involved with. It's about moisture, and it's about precipitation, and it's about measuring moisture, more specifically in the lower part of the troposphere, what we call the lower troposphere above the boundary layer. So I'll give you just a little background on that, some acknowledgement of some number of people, David Neal and some of the students at UCLA have been fundamental in setting the framework for the sort of fundamental physics of the investigation that I don't have expertise in. My request,
Is it possible you can use the mic?
You can continue to answer. Okay. So a little bit about myself. I'm from the Upper Peninsula, actually. I grew up in a town called Lyre Mountain, North Dakota, Michigan Tech. And I got my first experience with field work at that time. I got to spend the summer driving a truck, taking measurements with a geophysicist of the rock structures that you have in this part of the country that were, the Navy was investigating for an antenna system that they eventually built up here called ELF. Some of you are older, right, Illinois. Interestingly enough, so I was at his house one night, my advisor up there at Michigan Tech, and I was talking to his wife, and she said, well, you should meet my father. He's a rather famous meteorologist at the University of Wisconsin. His name is Werner Sumi. At that point, I had no idea who Werner Sumi was. I was 20-some years old. And, anyhow, I still keep in touch with them. Lois, Werner's daughter, and I still keep in touch. So let me plug this in. Maybe that helps a little bit. Yeah, after that, I worked for a while in Chicago. I worked for Motorola. I don't know if you've seen that movie, The Wall Street with Michael Douglas, where he's got the brick, big cell phone. You can talk for 20 minutes on it before it died. And then I think Myra gave you back on it. With the CSU, I got interested in radar systems, and then, of course, at NRL. And so I have a nice connection to the area here, and it's great to be back in this place. So we talk a little bit about moisture and extreme precipitation. This is something that's obviously, people are viewing the room. I think that even evidence the importance of measuring moisture, and this is the spherical structure. But from an observational standpoint, the area I would come from, it's been difficult to measure this moisture down low. It's just basic radiant transfer. Traditional infrared microwave soundings have difficulty penetrating through convection, measuring that moisture at lower levels, even radars for that example. jam radars are affected by attenuation, and sometimes even they can't measure precipitation down there. So, you know, it's a challenging regime to measure, and that's sort of what we have to do. There's a strategy for that. And behind this, this is some work from David Heelan's group. Todd Emmenegger is one of David's students. And they do a lot of work looking at what they call these pickup curves, where they're looking at precipitation conditioned on different layers of the lower troposphere, what I call an LFT here. This is just a figure that Todd gave me. He's showing a couple different climate models he's been looking at, one particular observation from the on-site here in black. And you can see the disparity amongst the models and this way of characterizing what they call this temperature, moisture, environment is sort of fundamental to the observing strategy. This is just a similar plot where instead of looking at the lower free tropospheric moisture, he's looking at the entire column of the moisture, a number of different models. This is also from Tom's paper. And the key thing here is that we're focusing on this area up here, where we're calling the high moisture, high precipitation, the area where I was mentioning earlier where a lot of satellite observations are challenged in getting observations. So you could envision overlaying actual observations on top of this. Perhaps can prove some of the parameterizations or things in the model, the assumptions you made on the role of moisture. So to do that, we can talk a little bit about the observational strategy now. And I got interested in radio occultation measurements when I came to JPL, mainly because it's, well, I didn't know much about it, but it's, you know, it's a real center for precise timing. Every satellite we have in space needs to know where it is, some like more precisely than others. So, long time ago, back in the 60s or so, people started using this concept for looking at planetary atmospheres, and eventually got picked up by a few people at JPL thinking, hey, we can do this for looking at Earth's atmosphere also. And we, about that time, the GPS system was getting deployed and being made available to people other than the military. And it's a very simple concept. If you have two satellites moving right here, you can draw a straight line between them, but the actual ray path is slightly bent through the index of refraction in the atmosphere. And that's largely due to gradients in the temperature and water vapor structure. It's not free space. There's an index of refraction that's slightly different as you propagate through the, what we call the limb of the Earth right here. And we, since you know this distance between the satellites very accurately, you can back out what we call this excess phase delay that's due to this bending. And from that, you can back out temperature. There's a whole retrieval process for it. I won't have time to go through it. But my interest was down here at the bottom. These measurements are done what we call L-band, which is about 1.4 gigahertz. At that frequency, you really can penetrate right through heavy convection without much of a problem. So when I saw this, I thought, well, we're getting temperature and moisture profiles through heavy convection. Maybe we could use some of these measurements to address some of the science questions I'll just show them in this slide. It's basically Snell's law. If you've seen the pencil and the glass of water bending toward the normal, sort of what I'm showing here. It's the same thing, except that in the atmosphere, the refractive index changes more gradually because temperature and moisture are changing more and more. So that's essentially what we're looking at here. So just going to put that quick slide in there. Some terms I'll talk about here. Some of you are more familiar with this than others. So here's your transmitter, here's your receiver, here's this, I've exaggerated this, of course. Here's this bent ray path. So as this ray path bends, the point that's closest to the Earth, we call that the tangent point. This point right here, if you did actually have a straight line distance, this place of this distance of closest approach, we call that the impact factor. And you hear this thing called the bending angle, and you can see kind of what that's defined here. So these are sort of common parlance, just like you talk about radar reflectivity in the radar world, for example. These are common terms used in the RO world when you're discussing the geometry of the measurement. And I'll talk about things called propagation paths or rays. The receiving satellite over here samples the measurements at about 50 hertz or something like that. So we actually, you know, you're sampling the data as these two satellites are moving apart from each other. So you get what you call an occultation that sets through the Earth. And you can think of these different samples as rays. You can actually do it in a sequence of these. So and I'll show a little figure that maybe makes that clear as well. There's quite a bit here. I don't want to go through it. But basically, it takes about 2 minutes for once these two satellites see each other in space. It takes about 2 minutes for one of these occultations to happen before they disappear. You know, when it falls behind the Earth and during that time, you sample quick enough that you can actually extract out temperature and moisture profiles with assumptions. I mean, nothing comes for free. There's some assumptions you have to make, but at about a 200 meter vertical resolution, so it's quite high in the vertical, but you can see it's quite coarse in this direction along the way, simply because it's a path. Even though this distance between the two satellites can be many thousands of kilometers, the actual, most of the bending occurs when you get through the moisture near the surface. So you roughly say the bending occurs roughly about 200 kilometers or so. Most of this bending is occurring about 200 kilometers away. So if you actually take that slide now, and I'm not very good at doing 3D depictions in PowerPoint. Here's a sequence of these rays, right, as this computation is setting. I'm trying to show more of the bending down here at the bottom. So at this tangent point, what happens, the two satellites are moving, or the Earth is turning, you know, the two satellites are moving relative to each other. So this tangent point doesn't stay at the same place on the Earth. It will move also, right? So I'm trying to draw here a trace of these tangent points as the occultation sets through the ground. And so during each RO, the drift is maybe 100 or maybe 200 kilometers. So it's not quite a straight vertical profile. I mean, as the occultation happens, this moves a little bit. So you have to take that into consideration as well. Tangent points are different. The other thing I wanted to show is, as I shown, that the resolution is really coarse in this direction along the ray, roughly. It's very fine in this direction, but at these frequencies, you have something called the Fresnel volume. It's a fundamental feature of the propagation through free space, and the Fresnel volume is only about a kilometer. In other words, if you were to look at these rays, like if I could stand over here and look at them in this direction, they're only about the propagation path is really about. So the point I'm trying to make with this slide is that, sure, the occultation is very coarse in one direction, but it's very fine, actually, in the other two directions. Sort of the opposite of when you look at traditional imagery from satellite data. We talk about footprints being fine scale. Maybe an infrared sound or something might be coarse in this way, or might be whatever. But occultation is a little bit different. It's fine in this way, but it's coarse in one of the one of the horizontals. So it's just a little different way of thinking about resolution.
Joe, can you mount a campaign that's thought out ahead of time where you take advantage of the constellation of satellites to get 3D high resolution?
People have looked at that. The density of these observations is getting quite high now with some of the commercial products. And I have a little chart to show you. It's a good question. So the most well-known of these measurements is Cosmic 2, which some of you are familiar with. This is NOAA. It's a joint measurement between NOAA and the government of Taiwan. It was launched a couple of years ago. It's six satellites, so six of these receivers. And they have these receivers can receive the telemetries from not just GPS, but from like Galileo and LONASS and some of the other telemetries that are broadcast. The point I want to make with this is that these satellites are moving independently of each other, but every now and then the occultations occur very close to each other, just with a time scale relative to convection, let's say 10 minutes, that's maybe even bigger for convection. Let's just say, so you might have some observations to get fairly close to convection. As you can see from the title of my talk, what I'm trying to get are occultation measurements that are very close to convection in pairs or in triplicates, enough that we could maybe look at the moisture surrounding. So let's take a look at what the data look like from Cosmic. If I can first show you an example, this is that same figure I showed you earlier with this more-free tropospheric moisture and the precipitation from a series of models. So you can see this disparity amongst the models in the lower-free troposphere. Well, this is one particular case where two Cosmic 2 occultations, kind of hard to see them, but one's in the red, one's in the green. The one in the red is passing through some heavy precipitation. This is some data from iMerge, the GPM product. And then the other one is out here in the environment surrounding the convection. And if you look at that occultation, I just plotted here the relative humidity. You can clearly see the moistening in the lower free troposphere. Not so much in the boundary layer, but in this lower free troposphere area. It's trying to, I made this figure just to show, if we maybe had a whole bunch of these, not just one or two in this case like this. maybe we could do some science work to address this problem. So if we look at, so if we look at all the data, this is all the data after what I call the quality control. And by quality control, I'm talking about taking data that get down into the body. So we'd like to take that lower free troposphere moisture and contrast it with what's in the body. That's one of the fundamental things that Neil and his group and others look at. So here's a map of these individual observations from cosmic. This is Weber per 1 degree group box, and I think the scale goes up to about 30. And this is over a 3 month period in 2022. So, you know, it's maybe, if you're lucky in the tropics, there are some cases that exceed 30. But most of the time, you know, is maybe you have 10, 15 in a 1 degree box over 3 months. Not the greatest sample of production, right? Not very useful. NASA has now started buying data from commercial sources. It's part of their commercial satellite data buy. They actually have proposals, actually no proposal right now, to do work with the data. So I'm showing data from Spire, which is one of the big weather provider companies. And if you add Spire data, it's really amazing, actually. They have a number of satellites flying in different orbits, tropical, polar, and so forth. You can see the sampling goes up by about a factor of 2. There's a little map over here. Maybe in the tropics, you go from 35, without Spire data, I think it's 25. It does help, you know, considerably with the sampling. So I think I wanted to show that just simply because this is data available to recently. It's not just me. You can go get this data from NCAP. But if we take and simply constrain that now by the and go into that and try and find out radio occultations that are fairly close to each other. My definition, as I said, is within 10 minutes and 200 kilometers. The sampling goes down quite a bit. You end up having, most of these occur way too far apart in time. So you really wouldn't be able to look at moisture near convection with any sort of scale of running. Even if you added the Spire data, you know, you're down to maybe four to five observations. So this is, it's looking pretty good. Coming to a slide where I'm going to explain why I did this. In fact, if you look at this, I did a whole map here. If you look at this whole case where you actually then go into these observations that occur close to each other and find ones where it's raining, not always raining, right? Maybe it's raining 10, 20% of the time. It's pretty dim. You'll end up with maybe 1,000 cases that pass. The reason I made this slide is because whenever you write up all with NASA, really want, or just using NASA as an example, and you want to argue for an observation from space, the first question they're going to ask is, can you do it with existing assets? Do you even need a satellite to can you do it from suborbital? So we did this whole exercise, and I was part of this, to really show that, you know, the observational strategy we wanted to come up with, which is the rest of our talk, is something we need to do because it's difficult to do this from with existing assets. So this whole idea of storm probe that I'm talking about, it's an acronym, it's down here at the bottom. It took us a while to come up with an acronym. Storm thermodynamic occultation for the role of moisture in polarimetric radio observations of the environment. So I even forget it sometimes. So I just put a little number after it. So what this measurement strategy is, instead of flying one radio occultation independently of all the others, if you fly them mostly spaced within about 2 or 3 minutes of each other, just under the fact that the Earth is turning in that 2 minutes between one occultation and another, whose ray paths through the occultations kind of slice through the space. Instead of doing that fortuitous matchup I showed earlier with existing assets, here you would have those pairs all done. So these occultations would always line up next to each other. They would still have this fairly coarse observation in what I call the long ray direction. But they would be fairly fine due to this Fresnel property in the crossway and most of the. So we came up with this idea called storm probe, where this would potentially, you know, you could show that you could capture independently moisture profiles within a nearby environment in the surrounding environment, within the convection and within the surrounding environment. Just the fact that these Fresnel zones are so narrow means that the moisture you sample here comes from an entirely different set of air than you get from this one and this one. In other words, the equivalent in imagery with the footprints down the well. That would be the equivalent terminology for the say, moisture for the engine or something like that. So these are very independent measurements and they slice through the storm and they're different. So this is the observing concept that you can have here. Here's a little better picture of it over 2 days. So here you can see this is just a dot. I put a dot wherever there was an occultation. You can see that the numbers come in triplicates, like I showed earlier. So there's always three dots next to each other. And if you, I just zoomed in here, and there's these, just like I showed earlier, you get these occultation paths occurring. Sometimes they're closer together, sometimes they're farther apart, depending on where the two satellites are in space. But if you miss that same figure I just showed earlier, just showing how we can capture these moisture gradients in the phosphate direction. In other words, we can nicely see the moisture gradient this way. We don't really know where it is this way because it's all averaged out with that long gradient. But in the phosphate direction, you can get some information. And if you had enough of these observations, as you can see here, you capture the gradients. That makes sense? So this is great. We have this observing strategy, but you still want to know if it's raining. Right? So if I wanted to know, if I wanted to make this kind of picture right here, right, this is just data from GPM. You can do that. You could go get some GPM data. I think they produce that at a 30-minute resolution. But it'd be nice if you get it at the same time. You could potentially look at how this moisture is varying in the vertical with a measure of the convection. So this is what I'm going to connect. This idea of what we call polarimetric RO was developed, something we were involved with the JPL in the development. So what we do here is on the receiving satellite, instead of just measuring the received signal at one polarization, we receive it at orthogonal polarizations. Some of you are familiar with the next round radars when they were upgraded about 10 or so years ago with dual polarization capability, the same sort of principle. In fact, when you propagate through aspherical media like precipitation, you reduce the cross-polarized signal because the particles are oblate and flat. So they flatten due to aerodynamic forces. So you get this phase delay at the same time you're measuring the temperature and moisture profile, you get a measurement of this phase delay. And by doing so, you get some idea of where the precipitation is at the same time. And I'll give you a little free shows it a little bit better. Here's a little graphic right here. This is like similar to what I showed you in that first slide when I was talking about the different terminology of the new occultation. So here's that same grade path, but it's passing through rainfall here where the signal gets equalized. This was shown by a group in Spain led by Esteban Bartolac at the University of Barcelona, actually convinced their government when they were actually launching a synthetic aperture radar. She actually convinced her government to put a demonstration instrument on that satellite, and they agreed. And so we had a demo of this in 2018. This had never been done before. In principle, it should work, right? It's pretty basic physics, but it had never been done. And so this satellite was launched in 2018. We spent a lot of time on it. This was done SpaceX deployment out of Vandenberg, not far from JPL, back in 2018. And the data's been, working well now for just about 5 years. I'll show you a few figures from it. It's the first proof of concept of this polarimetric radio occultation measurement. And I just happened to have a postdoc, actually, from Spain at that time. He got to go up and watch the launch. I don't know if he was able to see the data he was working on. Like I said, this has heritage in the polarimetric Doppler radar community. You can even open up your radar scope app on your iPhone and look at what they call propagation differential phase shift, that's commonly measured term. And you look at the next round products that come out now, not just Doppler velocity, but they produce a lot of these polarimetric measurements. The same thing, except the radio occultation being one way, right? It doesn't bounce a single lot. But it's basically the same principle as the interesting much that. But just to give you an idea of the measurement, I did not explain this too much, but you might say, how big is this signal? Right? Is it measurable? What's your thresholds? Well, with PAS, it turns out that the threshold, and I won't go into the details, it's about what we call it. Instead of measuring things in degrees, which is typically what you do for phase, you convert it to wave, convert it by 2 pi over lambda, convert it into distance. The measurement sensitivity for PAS is about 2 millimeters. In other words, it's about 2 millimeters an hour. So if the rain rate along this propagation path is about 2 millimeters an hour or greater, it's more or less. That's roughly what we see in the video. So if you call it, we're not quantifying the rainfall rate because it's really a path average, which is detecting the presence of that precipitation at the same time the rain range. So that's it. But one thing that, you know, the student alone, who was really, was at JPL looking at some early data, he said to me, he would come to me and say, look, I've seen all these signatures, not just in rain, but in the ice, and I'm mixing it, you know, in the melting phase, in the next phase. I've seen all these big, strong signatures that we didn't really, we thought they might be there, but not to this magnitude. Here's an example of one. This is a, some of you are familiar with the GPM radiometer. This is the 166 gigahertz channel, channel, very similar to the one in the US. And you can see very cold brightness, obviously very strong thunderstorm. There's a, the black lines are showing the rain path of the elevation. So you can see they're cutting through the heaviest part of convection. This is height right here, this is 12 kilometers. And you saw this big signal, right, up high, which clearly, you know, not looking for anything, well, maybe a little, well, probably none, but they're right, you know, certainly strong air motion mixing height and meters together. And in fact, the signal down in the rain was actually smaller than some of what we saw in the ice. So we're a little confused on this, but I'll talk a little bit about this. This was a unique signature we saw, and the immediate thing that came to me is that, wow, this looks like radar photons. Right? Like we could somehow use this information, maybe not so much in a quantitative fashion, but in a qualitative one, to measure how high the convection got. Right? It certainly got up, well, if we have a 2 millimeter threshold, that's a real signal. Right? So the convection got at least up to about 12 kilometers. And at the same time, we had this temperature moisture. Strong probe would allow us to do this with 3 satellites we had in a row. Hopefully some of them, you know, getting through the, you know, this one right here, this observation might cut through the convection. Another one out here might capture some of the air and so on. And Ramon actually went through all the data from this instrument, this Spanish instrument called Rock. He said, I just took the top percentile of all the data, the upper 2%, and just measured and put it on a map. The first thing you want to do is replicate climate knowledge. And say you can see something. And sure enough, if you look at just these red dots, which are cases where this polarimetric phase is getting up to at least 15 kilometers, they tend to show up in the region where you expect most of the heavy precipitable droplets. And actually, you can actually, these ones down here, 0 to 5 kilometers, maybe some of the shallower convection, maybe some that don't have much of those phase. They should, you know, like in southern oceans where there's a lot of rain. They didn't show up too. So this seemed like it matched climatology fairly well, the things we saw. In fact, that color scale underneath there, that sort of blue color you see under here, was actually GPM primary data for these 3 months, these same 3 months. This being, you know, June, July, August, this being the summer in the southern hemisphere, the summer in January, February. So it seemed that there was a nice matchup with climatology. So we knew that, you know, the signal, you know, was proof that this was really, you know, instrument is really this right here. So I'm going to go back to a little bit. Some of you who are familiar with ice microphysics, you know, I went back, if you go back to the signature here, you know, when you're in the rain, it's pretty easy to model it. I mean, it's things like the aerodynamic forces of water are such that you can model rainfall by things like pollute spheroids. And there's relationships between the axis ratio and the rain rate that are pretty well established. So that part's fine. We could model the rainfall pretty good. But in the ice, it's all over the map, right? I mean, ice microphysics is very complex. The morphology is know how to model that. So the beauty of these measurements as I mentioned, at L-band, is that the wavelength is very long. Yeah, the wavelength is about 20 centimeters. Right? It's big compared to the particle size. So things like Rayleigh assumptions are probably a pretty good assumption. Right? So we did a lot of work using what we call this discrete dipole approximation, which is a very exact, precise measurement of the scattering property of the crystals. And then we did it using fairly similar, very simple, these complex shapes, we just model them and use basically, in this case, polar wavelengths for this. And what would be the difference between the two? If we could do it, it would be, you know, this is one of the, I think, the difficulties in simulating a lot of the scattering from ice crystals that is so variable. If we could show that we could do it more simplified shapes, it might be easier to do it later. So if you actually look at this, kind of a confusing figure, but I think it's convention. So this is work from the wrong. So these are the aggregates, and then these are the more, what you might call the more pristine crystals that might be more, you know, similar to something you would find. And then if you look back at that curve, remember I showed you this, there was almost a linear relationship between this differential phase and the mass ratio. It's pretty much a straight line. So when we actually look at this assumption down here, it looks like, sure enough, the low densities here, right? You know, things like, you know, aggregated plates, aggregated densities, and so forth. Those seem to agree well with the smaller axis ratio. And the high density ice, high density particles, which would be approaching the pure ice density that comes on. And fairly low axis ratio would be better with the pristine crystals. So it seemed like maybe some of these assumptions that you have to make in these fairly complex calculations, when you do them at these frequencies, really assumptions that we do. And it just makes the scattering calculations a lot simpler. This will have, the reason I brought this up is because I have one slide in the end where I don't know, if you ever want to assimilate these kind of observations in the model, you have to have what's called a forward operator. Something in your model that can replicate your observations. The forward operator, if it's fairly complex, it might be something where you introduce a lot of error if you don't know how to do it correctly, or it could be computationally expensive. Things like Rayleigh approximations would allow you to do this in a much simpler way. This is something from a paper I just published recently. We actually looked at this signature through the ice and see, could we measure the integrated ice water path along each of these gray paths. Here's a little plot of right here showing the point where this tangent height, remember that plot I showed you with the tangent point in the very beginning, where it got only down to 7 kilometers, and this is one where it only gets down to 9. So we're pretty sure we're far enough above the freezing level where we're looking at pure ice. And sure enough, there's a pretty good relationship between this differential phase shift and the integrated. So there's some interesting analysis. Just came out. But it looks like we could do a pretty good measurement in an integrated ice water path. Again, these are big particles. We're not looking at cloud-sized ice or something like that. These are things that have to be measurable. Something that has a 20 centimeter wave. But, you know, pretty good, promising our measurement is differential. We call this delta Q, this differential phase, and this integrated ice water path. All right, I just wonder, I've got a few applications I've told you, I've got a few slides left. Some of you are familiar with data simulation. Radio occultations are assimilated into numerical forecast models. They assimilate the bending angle. The bending angle is the first thing you extract once you get the assumption. So it's untouched by any assumptions you make. Well, there are some assumptions, I get it. But it's a more pure measurement, so when you're comparing model simulations of bending angle, those observed things in the cosmic, you can do it for minimal error, let's just say. So if we could assimilate, instead of assimilating this very complex delta P, if we could assimilate what we call this polar lens of bending angle, it might be a little more straightforward way to assimilate these into numerical forecast models. The models are already set up to assimilate bending angle, you just have to do it twice, at one polarization. This is some work from Eric Wang, which is the one who's called wanted to point that out. Among others, there's a little campaign going on now with the people at JMA and ECMWF. ECMWF is working on a forward operator for more than that operations. This is very similar to that plot I showed you with the hurricane for that thunderstorm in South America earlier. So they're comparing forward simulated forward ranging signatures being mapped as opposed from populations from the Spanish instrument, but in some cases pretty good agreement. This is all sort of like work being done for their development of their forward operating that they hope to put in place at the UW-Madison. And last bit is tropical meteorology. One thing, as you might suspect, this is from a proposal for that we submitted to NASA. As I said, they like, you have to have a nice science story. They'd like to see what else can you do with the data. If you're spending a lot of money, you'd like to do a little more than just look at these convection, convective statistics that they showed you once. That's interesting, but can you do something applied that NOAA can use, right? Well, one thing that came to mind was tropical hurricanes. NOAA often does sortings out to hurricanes with their Gulfstream and other aircraft. Sample and drop signs, in and near the perimeter of the developing tropical cyclones. There's a good by John Spitzlap on that. John, I talked to John about this last year. Sometimes, though, these observations that they want to take are far away. They're closer to Africa or something. So that by the time the plane gets there, they only have an hour or two on station time. And a lot of times, the pilots just avoid the convection. So the drop signs don't even, they can't even put them where they want. Not all this, but I'm saying this does happen. So the fact that these storm probe observations occur like three in a pair, as I showed you three at a time, they could potentially complement drop zones. I mean, they're not the quality of the drop zone, they don't measure the measurements at the precision you might get from the drop zone, but they do happen here and could potentially complement. So what I showed here is just, these are all the storm tracks from 2020. And then the dot is wherever there was one of these simulated storm cone observations that fell within 200 kilometers of the storm. Just to show you that, there's quite a bit of sampling you might have, even if difficult. This is year 2020. If you actually do the math, add up the numbers, you look at, say the tropical season is June through November, and you look at just the Atlantic Basin, you get quite a few. These stands for depression. In other words, when the storm is below category one, you get quite a good sample. And you might even sample a few of category one. This is just 1 year. You can do this for other years and get numbers that are different by a factor of two or three or four, depending on the hurricane and some of that data. But it would be a way to complement eventually some of the drops in the community and stuff. So that's it. I wanted to finish a little earlier. Describe this operational strategy that the past storm probe consists of these closely spaced radio application measurements that employ this polarimetric canopy. And this would enable us to get measurements of moisture, in particular what we're focusing on, smaller than troposphere surrounding heavy precipitation. So I try to give you a little feel for maybe some of the other things you can do with the radio. I have quite a few slides on how to cut out. I think a lot more you can do with this, but I'd like to point out that a lot of this data is free and open. We've got like 5 years of data from the swap experiment. You get about 200 applications a day. So I don't know what that is over 5 years, but good number. So if you're interested in looking at some of these data, Mary is here, and she knows all about it. The other as well. And we like to stimulate people using the application. It does provide this fine scale data for some of the things that you can do. So, for a number of US are looking at convective science, basically. So, anyhow, happy to talk more about this now or if they need something like that. I'd just like to thank everybody for having me here and getting back to the response. It feels good to be back in the whole day.
Like so.
Unfortunately, I have a couple sisters up in the one in Appleton and one in Green Bay. I called them and told them, I'm coming out here in February. They said, well, that's too bad. That's the week we're going to Florida.
I don't know anything about what you're doing or what Myra's doing except from our interview talk, so I'm looking forward to a long relationship with learning more. One of the things that comes to mind immediately to me, two things. One is if you don't get very much resolution along the ray, but if you have an independent data set where you can say, you can actually look at what the convective elements look like, how good a guess is it to say, if I know what the across ray gradient of moisture is at, say, 10 kilometers, I can really pretty much tell what it is in the other direction just by inspection, right? Can you use that as a reasonable proxy for in initializing some study?
Perhaps. I thought about that. I didn't look into that more. In terms of the, let's go back to the cross rate for example. So that was a criticism we had when we were proposing this by somebody else at JPL. They said, hey, we have years of errors with that, which is very good where it doesn't enter the clouds. Could you use that as your, like, quote unquote, upside? I thought I was a little worried about that because the fidelity, there's two different measurements, the difference between them might be such that it obfuscates any signal that's in the real physics. You could do that and you could still try it, but I wanted to have three identical observations in the cross ray. Now, in the along ray, as you're saying, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of these tracking algorithms people are developing now. We may end up, if this does go forward, we would probably want to deploy those just to see how the precipitation is evolving. Satellites are snapshots, right? They can fly. You don't know what's happening in time. So that would be something we would look at. Maybe back out there.
Can I ask another one? Can I
walk through
it? Can radio occultation give you really high resolution information about the tropopause at all latitudes?
Yes. Yes.
That seems like
I can show you that.
Really interesting application.
We were actually looking, not with this data set, so this is polarimetric radio occultation, but with the standard radio occultation from Cosmic 2, we actually did collocations over hurricanes. And we got a number of them that are actually over different systems. And you can get really high resolution information about the tropopause. I mean, and again, it depends on how you find the tropopause, but I've done that too. So, yeah, if you want to see that, you can talk. Because I have hundreds of those cases.
Oh, great.
Hundreds or thousands, actually, at this point.
So, how accurate are the moisture measurements, and how do you compare? Like, you brought up errors. It's like, how does it compare to some of the accuracy of some of the other approaches to get moisture?
I'm a microwave radiator. I'm a microwave radiometer guy, so I'm always intensive with that technique. But those measurements have always been challenged when getting errors.
Right.
You might be able to get some upward cloud information, but it's just fundamental radio transfer radiation that is difficult to send down below. The wave function. Absolute accuracy, I can't remember that. But the measurements, one of the reasons that I think that rate these data have such a positive impact on forecast models is that they're relatively modest. One observation to the next to the next. It's a fairly, it's a time measurement. So the consistency amongst the observations is very. It would be higher, I would assume it would be higher as you get down into the troposphere.
Yes.
The phase delay is just
okay. I can follow up. on that. I was just kind of curious. Yeah, thanks.
So, do you have a feel for how long of a transmission path length you need between the receiver and the transmitter before, in order for the phase angle to be accurately determined enough that you can actually get an estimate of the water vapor content? And I guess what I'm wondering is...
The water vapor or the ice water, referring to that stuff I was showing about extracting ice properties? Is that
no, actually, to the refraction.
Well, the two satellites are thousands. I mean, they can be thousands of kilometers apart. So
well,
I think that distance matters so much. The clocks are able to travel.
Okay. So the reason I was asking is...
But it's the change, right? It's excess, actually, it's the relative change between samples.
Right, the path delay, right. So would these be measurements that could be made within the troposphere? Could you do these suborbitally rather than?
Yeah, in the troposphere, for sure.
Well, I mean, could you do them from aircraft, for example?
Oh, yeah.
Would that?
That's a good question. There are people that do this from aircraft, and even from balloons, too. In fact, it's an interesting measure. The group actually on the scripts in 1678 was very active in airborne radio occultation because they routinely fly them for atmosphere and river.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they fly out and drop. They drop drop zones, but they also complement these airborne radio occultations. And they're actually, I think, building an operator for the airborne model. They're very, very interesting. I don't know. The airborne ones.
Any other questions, comments?
You wanted to talk about what we use to use.
Yeah, those from the students. We have a few students who have expressed interest in going to the industry, and we don't have obviously a lot of that experience in house. Can you give them a little bit of your perspective of what it was to be in DOD, industry, now NASA?
I mean, it was a different time. Back then, I wanted to do something more theoretical, and I left the industry and go back to college for that. I think now in the weather field, which is happening, there's a lot more than just a lot of these small companies now are providing weather applications. And NOAA and NASA are buying some of that. I think there's probably opportunities in that area. It's kind of a contentious topic, because you still want to convince people that you need a solid national satellite program, but it's not enough, right? We're not going to be able to put up enough populations on the industry to get them all this But I think there's probably opportunities in that area. You know what? I'll be up front. I mean, at JPL, we had a couple of people meeting for joining these companies, but some of them came back.
Oh, yeah, we have had some of those that had left and came back when I was there, yeah.
If you wanted to do the science, you know, you didn't want to do the science.
Any other common question? Ben, can we do radio flotation with your aircraft?
Oh, yeah.